Hello and welcome. This is Chala Dinkoy, CEO and founder of The Repositioning Expert. Welcome to another edition of my podcast, Naked Marketing. Michael is not only not naked, but he's not even sitting. I love the fact that this man stands for all of his meetings all day on Zoom. And has that been like for the whole pandemic in the last year, Michael?
Actually, we built a brand new building in Fort Wayne, Indiana about 4 years ago. And really kind of modernize the office space, open architecture, have standing desks. And so I probably stand about 95% of the time in the office as well as my home office here during the pandemic.
My God. Now we're going to find out about your business, but I'm just fascinated. Has that made a difference in your health?
No, not so much my health, but just the energy. You know, we've gone to wireless headsets. You used to be connected. And I'm a pacer when I talk. So it's been really helpful for me just to walk around and things. But more than anything, it's just, especially when I'm doing a lot of virtual speaking engagements, I'm up against my backdrop. It's as close to being on a stage as we can during the global pandemic.
Wow. Okay. Well, so please tell us what you do.
So we work with so many Americans who just are a little bit queasy about whether they're going to run out of money. We have an income alpha approach that uses protected income that increases the probability of retirement success. At the end of the day, when you increase that retirement success, you feel more confident, you feel more sure about your retirement. And most importantly, you sleep better at night.
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. So how do you do all that?
Pardon?
How do you do that? How do you make all that happen?
Actually, we use a lot of protected income. We use a proprietary tool called Journey Guide. It takes about 20 minutes to take a client through there. We can show you the right amount of protected income, which would be Social Security, your defined benefit plan, if you're fortunate enough to even have a defined benefit plan anymore, and then also to purchase an annuity. We work with advisors all over the country that ultimately work with clients. And so we're educating advisors on how the proper use of protected income works and that they can actually leverage with their client to become more referable, more valuable in one of the greatest shifts from the workforce to retirement that we've seen here in the United States.
This is fascinating. Of course, I'm in Canada. You realize we have, I don't know if you know anything about Canada, but we have an RRSP, which is probably our retirement savings program. So I guess by protected, that's what you're talking about.
Exact same thing. You can't outlive it. It's protected by the insurance carrier. It's protected by the Canadian government. Absolutely very similar.
So is it simply just taking what I have in my RRSP and reinvesting it in a different way than what my wealth advisor does?
Well, your wealth advisor would coordinate your retirement income plan here in the United States with Social Security, and then they would use what we call a systematic withdrawal approach, where they're using your assets each and every year to supplement your Social Security income. The problem is that if you have bad sequence of returns, in other words, several bad market years early in your retirement, that starts a really bad snowfall and you can run out of money. And then you're just left impoverished with Social Security. By taking some of those assets now, putting those into guaranteed income, you actually give yourself a wider safety net. You can become more aggressive with your investments and actually get your investments to last longer, or you can actually use less assets to generate the same amount of income so that you can apply that to long-term care, legacy type of products like life insurance and things to round out your overall financial plan.
That's amazing. Now, did you discover this or did somebody teach this to you?
So we were very fortunate to recruit someone who is on the patent for the Black-Scholes investment model, which is a famous investment model. We ask a very simple question. Doesn't an annuity help or hurt an investment portfolio? This guy's a great mathematician, obviously, came back 3 weeks and his eyes were really bright. He said, no one's ever asked us to figure this out, but it certainly makes sense. And so we've worked with several different universities to test the model. The model tests out. We spent the last 5 years building a great tool that is very client-centric. Engages in co-planning so that you sit with the advisor to move a lever saying, I want to push out my retirement by 2 years, or I want to retire 2 years earlier, perhaps. within 2 seconds, you see the results of that. So we're really heavy into co-planning, and that puts us in a great speed to trust. And then that also helps us from an education standpoint about how does protected income fit into your plan? And if it doesn't, that's fine. At least you know that you've had the option.
So when you were born, did you first become a investment advisor, or were you in finance? Like, how did this all happen to you?
Well, my father worked for an insurance carrier for 42 years. So a lot of insurance conversations happened around the dining room table. Then I studied finance in college, worked in the banking environment. And the banking environment in the mid-80s here in the United States really began to merge and sell different products like insurance. And so that's how I got entrenched into it. I went out, I was my own financial planner for a while before I got lured into wholesaling to have a greater reach across the United States.
Wow, that's wonderful. Now, I'm a marketer, so I'm always interested, before we get to your big marketing mistake, who is your primary target? Is it the actual end user, or is it the financial advisor, or is it both?
Our main customer is the advisor. We do have an initiative for business to consumer, but we're very careful not to step on our current advisor's toes. So we're using a lot of data to go to, I always pick on Peoria, Illinois, because we don't have a footprint there. And so we're doing a lot of target marketing with Facebook and Google and those types of digital advertising to approach customers who are being underserved. The people that are under $500,000 of assets that aren't getting good advice. And we can do that through our sales desk called financialendurance.org.
Very, very nice. Okay. Well, I mean, do you act? So that's sort of the advertising online kind of thing, but is there any other way that you market to get into, you know, the heads and the ears of the advisors?
Yeah, the pandemic has actually forced us to accelerate a lot of plans. I'm sure you hear that all the time. We have 19 wholesalers that largely live and work into their territories. They're responsible for multi-states of sales. And so we really rely on them to be the face of Ash Brokerage and to really educate their advisors inside of their territory. Now, what we've also have is a desk of 14 people in Fort Wayne, Indiana, largely that are calling out, trying to educate and motivate advisors. But what's really significantly changed is that we've been able to use video technology through a great program called Allego that allows us to create 2 to 3 minute videos. We can use it on social media, which we've not done very well up to the pandemic, but also reach out to those people and differentiate ourselves with a voice, with a face, and with an appropriate message. And we actually have better response from that. And so that's been a game changer for us. And our performance showed last year, we actually grew our business in 2020, which we're one of the few brokerage general agencies, firm like us, that actually grew their annuity business during the global pandemic. And I think that the pivot to video technology was really critical for us.
That's fabulous. That is really great. So now is the time, I think, to talk about that mistake. So tell us about what your biggest mistake was when you were starting out and you didn't know what you were doing.
Yeah, probably waiting on a pandemic to change some of our philosophies, right? So many times, a lot of people in marketing are afraid to put themselves out there, especially the introverts. We're worried about image. We're worried about this. We're worried about things that really don't matter. At the end of the day, if you have a mindset of helping people and actually providing education, you can derive value in a variety of different ways. The channel no longer dictates. It's no longer just hand-to-hand combat. You have to be on video. You have to be on social media. You have to be on YouTube, and you have to approach people in different ways. I was always a phone guy, calling referrals, asking people, hand-to-hand combat. If I had listened to people and branched out further during my retail career, I would have had much more success in my retail career. And we've been pretty aggressive at Ash Brokerage, but I look back and I say, boy, if I had started doing this 5 years ago, you know, before it was the thing? How far ahead would I be from our competition? You know, there's a great question that that I heard from our CEO of the financial service professionals, and I challenged my sales team today on it. And it's like, if you're starting a wholesale operation today, what would it look like? And that way you don't have the excess baggage, but also you're thinking, how do I use the tools today? How do I use the digital advertising? How would I market today and going in the future? And who would I market to build my business, not who's helped me? I think that's a strategic conversation in your head that you have to get comfortable with before you even start thinking about marketing.
Yeah, one of my mentors has a really great saying, only wet babies like change.
And yes.
Like, so true, especially about what you're saying. And mindset is one of the hardest things to change. Mm-hmm. So I know that that's the mistake that you made. I love that because my business entirely shifted during COVID. In fact, like it stopped because the borders closed from Canada. There's nothing you can do about that because I used to speak at every conference and, you know, close business. And then I ported everything just like you did to reaching out online and never having to be x-rayed at the border again. So I totally love what you're saying. Now, having said that, what marketing mistakes do you see your targets making, like the wealth advisors? I mean, I've written blogs about wealth advisors who have no wealth. And in some ways, they are really only taught to, like, anybody with a pulse, just, you know, dial and dial and dial, just like what you were probably taught. So tell me what are some, from your perspective, some of the mistakes that you're seeing?
Yeah. So we see two mistakes, but you still end up having marginal success with those two mistakes. As you said, when you enter the business, think of a quadrant. And that lower left-hand quadrant is just what you described. Hold up a mirror. If they fog it up, prospect them, right? And then typically we have success in one of two ways. Either we define a small target market like attorneys or doctors or wherever is your natural market. We sell a lot of products to them and we get deep, but it's not scalable to other target markets for whatever reason. The other side is that we end up selling a lot of term insurance, as an example, to a lot of people, but then we're not able to scale that up to different products because we're known as the term guy and we're deep into service. What we try to do is focus in on processes and behavior in order to move you to a high performing practice. That means being innovative with something like Income Alpha. That means automate your prospecting, having the right copy. Now, to answer your question, I think one of the biggest things that I see across our industry is that we fail to clarify our message. You know, with Don Miller's book, it's if you confuse, you lose. As a wealth manager, we try to say, I do estate planning, I do wealth management, I do this. It's too much for the average brain to grab onto. You have to be crystal clear. The other thing that I see a lot is that we always try to be the hero of the client's story. We always throw out our designations, you know, a CFP, and this is why you should be working with me. It's not why anybody chooses. They choose because you can help them get to their goal and you help them win the day. You become a guide to that person. So having a clear message and always remaining in that guide position, allowing the client to be the hero, I think are the two biggest mistakes. But as a baseline, you've got to have automation. You've got to have the right copy. You've got to have the right people and processes to move yourself to that high performing practice quadrant.
That's wonderful. I know you talked about advertising online, but what outreach are you doing? So say on LinkedIn, are you doing any automation there?
Yeah. So what we're doing, we're trying to and trying to get click-throughs through LinkedIn, like eBooks, lead generation material. We just created some systemic social media posts for our entire 19 external wholesale team to use so that we can get some consistency of message. And then they can download their eBooks. They can download their Calendly. They can do that. The other thing is that gives us data analytics about what's working, what's not working. We're trying to learn. And from a financial services industry, we haven't we've started making that digital move, but we're really poor at using data analytics. And I think that the firms that are going to be able to win the day are going to be those people who really understand the data and then can apply the findings to future marketing efforts.
Big data is the way, for sure, for mm-hmm. sure. Everything you stream, it comes about because of big data. I mean, it's crazy. Everything.
Exactly. Yeah.
So you talked a lot about video, how it's played such an important role. And one of the big things that I ask my guests on the Naked Marketing Show is because you truly are, you feel naked when, you're on camera. What has come up for you when you had to do that? What were some of the fears?
Well, just the fear of image, the fear of like, hey, is this relevant? And you don't know. At the end of the day, you have to be passionate about the product or service that you're selling. And what I always reminded myself early on is that this is information that needs to get out. We can help millions and millions of Americans have a better lifestyle. If you keep that in mind, whatever you're selling, you know, there's a benefit. And you're the educator, you're the voice of reason. I tell people that, you know, we're the beacon in the stormy skies, and you've got to be out there. And I always try to get myself in that position. At the end of the day, you know, there's some things that you do logistically, upgrade the camera, put a nice ring light, you know, have a nice backdrop, all kinds of different things that you can spruce up your image and you can really differentiate yourself really quickly, unfortunately, in today's world.
Fortunately or unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this is all great stuff. Thank you so much, Mike. Where could people reach you?
Well, they can reach us at highperformingpractice.com. So again, thank you for having me on the show. I've enjoyed it. I love talking about marketing and sales.
Yes. Thank you so much for being here.